Hey, brothers and sisters, this is your brother from another mother, Brother Patrick here in North Carolina. Hope you guys are doing all right today. I want to try to have time to make a few videos, but first I just want to make a video of announcements. I will be, as I've mentioned in videos, I will be in Nashville, and I'll be seeing people on the 13th. I've already got my schedule kind of booked up through, say, about 3 o'clock in the afternoon on the 13th. And so I'll be available anytime, basically 3 until about 11 p.m. I still got open time, and I just asked you, brothers and sisters in the Nashville area, to RSVP me. Just message me and let me know. That way you can give me your cell number. I'll give you my cell phone number. That way we can make sure that we're going to meet there. I'll be staying at a hotel right in front of the airport, just adjacent to it. I forgot the name of it right now, but if you're going to meet me, then of course I will give you the name. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I'll be there. And praise God, by the grace of God, I'll have a vehicle to use. I'll be getting a vehicle in Nashville, so praise the Lord for that. And I thank you for all those who have prayed, and I ask you to pray that the vehicle that someone is letting me use will endure until the end. Praise God. Brothers and sisters, also, I'm, you know, scheduling last year. I was unable to go to all the places that I had wanted to go. The Lord had me wait. And so this summer, this season, while I'm here in the States, I'm intending on going to those places on the top of my list are Seattle, which would be the northeast area, Vancouver, Seattle, and Portland. By the grace of God, there's lots of people up there, probably a good dozens of people who I need to see, who need to be baptized and all kinds of stuff, prayed for healing and different kind of things, and salvation, evangelism, and of their relatives and stuff in that area. And then Dallas, of course, I'll go back to Dallas again this year, and then also to Chicago area, it looks like, and maybe even to the Northeast. I'm still waiting on the exact on that. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I ask you to please message me. My email is below this video. My email is below every video. Please email me and RSVP with me. Let's discuss and get it set up and plan that time frame to be in these areas. So I'm looking to go to these areas in August, every month, go somewhere to these places as the Lord is leading me to go, brothers and sisters. And wherever else, just please contact me and let's make a plan. By the grace of God, it will happen this season while I'm in the States. Also, it's almost time to send the boxes to the Philippines. I keep forgetting to mention it in the video. Sister Pearlie has sent boxes like 4 or 5 times. We've sent boxes like twice a year from Sister Pearlie. She lives in the greater Chicago area. And what we do is she is Filipino, who's American citizen, and she has contacts to send the stuff. Now, I've told Americans in the past don't send directly, and some of them did and had real bad experiences. The stuff was stolen. That's the way it always is. I mean, that's one reason why the Philippines is a third world country, brothers and sisters. There's all these third world countries are about the same, you know. It's just, but if you know somebody, that's why, by the grace of God, God gave us Sister Pearlie, and she knows people. And then, you know, she's from the Philippines. And so she's able to send the stuff and even consolidate it and send it at a bulk rate. You know, it's like $80 or $90 for a great big box, you know, full of stuff, a giant box. And so in that giant box, you know, lots of people can send children's summer stuff. We don't need any winter clothes. It's always hot in the Philippines. Children's summer clothes, school supplies, crayons and coloring books, Christian children's books. Because, you know, most of the children, if they go to school, they can understand English. Now, the kids that we work with, you know, because we feed like 1,000 street kids a week. Of course, a lot of them never went to school. Now, the orphans are going to school. That's a different thing. We have, I'll talk about that in a second. But anyway, so the young people in the churches that we do the feedings through, they all went to school and they can all speak English. And so they read the books and they translate it to the kids in the local language. So you probably can't get any Christian children's books in the language of where we're at there in Mindanao Island, which is Cebuano. It's almost impossible to get. So, of course, English is fine because it can be translated. You know, and they can see the pictures and all that. So we've had great success with those kind of things, children's Bibles with a picture, stories, and all that kind of stuff in there. They really enjoy it and they love it. You know, most of these kids, they have no running water, no electricity, so they have no television, and they can only see TV. If they, you know, if you go to these poor areas in the Philippines, what people do is, I remember I made a video before the first time I went to the Philippines. There was the first people in this village got a television, and it wasn't a really that poor of an area, but they got the first television. This was in 1999, and then all the local people came and stood outside that little house they lived in, because it's kind of like a hut, stood outside and looked through the window and all day long and watching the television. So, you know, like 100 people. So, you know, there's no privacy in a country like Philippines. You know, it's communal living. And I always say, you know, how they have all those kids, I do not know, because there's no privacy. But especially when you live in a hut, you know, with, like, you can see through the walls and stuff, because it's like a woven bamboo. Anyway, brothers and sisters, somehow they're still able to have 100 kids per family. But anyway, brothers and sisters, we have got children now at the third and the fourth orphanage. Like I say, I invite you guys, under every video, I put the link to the Facebook group. I invite you guys to join the Facebook group. And I post pictures. Almost every day I post some pictures of one of the feedings or something about the orphanage, the orphans, you know, from vacation Bible school, and when they, Christmas time, whatever, blah, blah, blah. I always post pictures all the time. I ask you to invite you to look at that and enjoy it. And brothers and sisters, now I've said this something similar way back. I just want to mention this again. I want you to think about this. Of course, I'm probably preaching to the choir, because when I do a video about the rapture, thousands of people watch it. When I do a video on an entire update about the orphanages or something, it's only, you know, a few hundred people that see it. And I want to say this. That tells you what you need to know about how the church has waxed cold. Like, and I just mentioned this. There are people, they can start, let's just say, a Facebook group, a new Facebook group. And they can, you know, and whenever I made this video, sometimes people get convicted and they get mad. And I don't, you know, me, I don't care, because the truth, people need their feet, toes stomped on. And that's why I'm saying this, that they might wake up and think about the priorities in their heart. And that's the whole point of what I'm saying here. Not about just Joshua's ministry, but if you go on YouTube, our Facebook, and you look at groups, say a group on Facebook, like talking about Christian groups, let's say about rapture dreams or about Bible codes and all this. Someone can start a group on Facebook today, have thousands of people go on there. If there's some kind of way they can find out what's the date of the rapture, what's the date of the beginning of the tribulation or the second coming of Christ or whatever, you know, somebody's parlor game of using all these different people use, you know, as I made the joke before, the square root of the earth times the sum of their shoe size times the number they saw in a dream, and connect all of these loose dots together and calculate out the date of the rapture and all this. I've seen it. There's almost daily somebody messages me with a calculation for the rapture date. And this is so popular. Even like the stuff with Jade Helm and all that. It's just... there was a guy I was on a radio show with. It's a nice guy. The Common Sense website. It's Brother Dave Hodges. Nothing against Brother Dave Hodges, but you know, when we're talking about Jade Helm and all that, it's just people are just by the thousands are just all over this kind of sensationalism. Even though there may be, you know, there's some truth to, you know, it's leading to something bad. We know that, but in the meantime, you know, there's thousands, and at least just in the Philippines, not only in the whole world, but in the whole world, of course. In the whole world, if you count even all of Christendom now, I'm talking about denominations and groups that aren't even born again, like Roman Catholicism and all this, you're talking 2 billion people. So the world is 7 billion. So there's 5 billion, at least, it's probably really 6 billion at least. Let's just be conservative and say 5 billion people in this world. So 5 out of 7 people in the world are not saved, going to hell if they die today. You know, in America, the statistics I saw in 2000 when I studied it, when I first got into the ministry, 3 million people die every year in the United States. And allegedly 1 million are saved. And that was in 2000. And that's counting all Christian sects, you know, sects, S-E-C-T. Sex that are not even, a lot of them not even really born again. So conservatively 2 million people die every year in the United States who are not saved. And other countries it's much worse, like the Philippines or whatever. We are feeding, by the grace of God, 1,000 street kids, poor, you know, squatter area people whose parents don't work and they don't go to school and they're drunkards and all this kind of stuff, but they keep having kids and are probably not 90% of them not even married. Because in the Philippines, they make it very difficult to get married, you know, like they want to do in the States. Like in Tennessee, I remember they were trying to have some thing where you have to go to seminars to get married and all this. Well, what ends up happening, I saw it in the Philippines myself, they make it all these hoops you got to jump through and all this paperwork and government processes. Nobody wants to go through that. And particularly poor people don't have the money to go through all these processes. So what do? They just don't get married. They end up shacking up. So it ends up being one of the big problems in the Philippines. The people aren't even married. 90% of the people, or I don't know what, let's say, I back off of that. Let's say 70% of the people are not even married because it's just too big of a hassle. So it ends up being a negative, not a positive. Anyhow, so brothers and sisters, what I'm trying to say is that there's all of the world is going to hell in a handbasket. And we, the body of Christ, instead of, you know, like a, what am I saying here? Like Jade Helm. I mean, the hour's already late. It's almost time for the rapture. The America is really no longer a Christian nation, but the time for the church to do something was 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago. And they just stood by, basically stood by and joined the world, you know, when television came. And then, like the Lord had given me to write about in the book, you know, Elvis was controversial in the 1950s because of the way he moved. And some preacher stood up against it. And then you watch television shows about the history of rock and roll, and they mock those preachers as some kind of, you know, inbred hillbilly rednecks. When in reality, those redneck preachers were right. What Elvis did led to Marilyn Manson. It led to gangster rap, you know, about killing people. It led to, you know, the divorce rate we have in the United States and the legitimacy rate, alcohol, drugs, and all that. It's all interconnected, sex, drugs, and rock and roll. And not necessarily in that order. Tune in, turn on, and drop out. All those things. It's already, the church has not been there. And so, what I'm saying is, when I look at these groups and all that, and all the church, instead of thinking about being the body of Christ, like the song by Casting Crowns, if we are the body, why aren't our feet going? Why aren't our hands reaching and healing and all that? Instead of being the body of Christ that we are, as the Bible says, that we are the body of Christ, you know, with the temple, as 1 Corinthians chapter 3 says that, you know, we are that body of Christ. We are the temple of God. We are, and people always, you know, focus on about being holy, but it's saying that we're, you know, we as the body, you know, Jesus is the head of the church, not a pope or not a preacher, not a bishop or anybody, but the Lord is the head. We're supposed to be having the mind of Christ and the will of Christ, as God wants none to perish, but all to come to repentance. The Lord wants us to be evangelizing, to feeding the poor spiritually and in the natural. All those things that you could write a list, what would Jesus do if he was here? I'm sure Jesus would not be worried about what day the rapture is and trying to calculate it and running to and fro about what's going on with all the stuff with martial law in the States or whatever it may be. And that's all this sensationalism and all of this shouting and carrying on in sensationalism about exaggerated news stories. What the Lord wants us to do is win the lost and to seek and save. Jesus came, he said, I came to seek and save the lost. And that's what it is, going after that one sheep out of 100 that needs to come into the kingdom. Now that's the mission that the Lord gave us, brothers and sisters, not all of this nonsense. And so, if you would like to look at the photos and stuff we have of the orphanages and updates and about sending stuff there and all this, the link is below every video that I have. And like I said, most of the people's going to watch this. If I title it update, will only be those who already have the heart for the true work of the Lord. You know, to minister to the lost, to minister to the poor, as Jesus said. You know, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the good news to the poor. Now, of course, it's poor in spirit and then the natural poor too. You know, that's why Jesus literally was talking about a rich man, financially rich. It's hard. It's easier for the camel to fit through an eye of a needle than a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. So there's spiritual poor, and then it's really the natural poor too. So anyway, brothers and sisters, praise God. You know, I thank the Lord for every one of you who have helped me with the orphanages and the feeding programs and all the work. We've built some churches in the Philippines and the Crusades, and then You know, those have some people have personally given to me for my travels. You know, when I'm traveling back and forth to the Philippines, and like now, I'm getting ready to go to Nashville, and then by the grace of God, Seattle, and meet with the brothers and sisters there, and pray with them, and answer their questions, and be a pastor to the brothers and sisters face to face, as the Lord would have me do. And you know, it's such a blessing to be a pastor to people. Face to face, the internet's it's not as easy as it is in person. So I thank the Lord for those things, brothers and sisters. But anyway, there's other ministries. I don't want to name who, when, where, why, and how. But you know, this ministry is not the only ministry by no means, brothers and sisters. But there's lots of stuff out there. Is what I'm saying is nonsense, and it's not what the Lord would have us do. And that's why it says that Jesus said that in the last days the love of many would wax cold. I just talked about that in the last video. And people are just so, what's the right word, self-absorbed, the me generation, as they say. It's really sad. And so if this applies to you, take it to heart. You know, I don't, you know, it's not about, like I said, it's just not personal. When I preach, or when someone is really preaching from God, it's not personal. It's the message of the Lord for the church. And then whomever it's intended to step on their toes, or to exhort people and rebuke people and to be in season and out of season. That's what it's for. So God bless you guys, and you know that I love you guys. And as I have time, I have lots of videos to make. I want to go into further about the baptism of the Holy Spirit and do some videos about receiving that. And by the grace of God, I plan on doing that as I have time here in the ministry, brothers and sisters. So God bless you all. I hope you guys all have a good day. And may the peace of the living God be with you today as you go into this fallen world and deal with all the things in this fallen world, brothers and sisters, even your relatives, your co-workers, whatever, your husband, wife, and all this. Lots of people, most of the people I deal with on YouTube, you know, their husband or wife is a non-believer or a backslider, lukewarm at best. This is normal. It seems to be almost everyone's in that place. But I see, when I see a husband and wife who are both strong in the Lord, you know, they usually go to a church and they usually get active. And if the church is, like a lot of them have fallen away, if it's a good church, they can really excel. So God knows, and God gives us grace for the, you know, the situation that we're in. He knows, and it's a lot of people, they weren't saved when they got married, you know. And it's after they got married, they got right with God, then boom, you know, here they are with their spouse who's not right with God. I mean, it's the most common story that we see as a pastor. You know, so, God knows your struggles. God knows your situation. God knows that, there's lots of people, they would love to go be a missionary in the Philippines. They would love to, you know, go serve the Lord. They'd love to go, you know, build an orphanage, but their spouse is anti-God person, you know, and doesn't want to, you know, they're not, you know, and the Bible says in Amos 3:3, how can two walk together except they be in agreement? So we have those struggles, and God knows, brothers and sisters. That's why we have to pray for our husband or wife and pray that God would move on their heart. And then, you know, God knows that we're one flesh, and so He understands. I mean, you just can't do it when you're married. You just can't go do what you want, whether you be the husband or the wife. You still have limitations of what you can do without the consent and approval of your spouse, either man or woman. So this is the things that we struggle with, and the majority of people who are in the church, and you know, the number one struggle probably, and the Lord knows this, brothers and sisters. He knows it. So just give it to Him. Give it to Him. Give it to the Lord. And He, you know, the Bible says, let the weak say, I am strong. You know, turn it over to the Lord. He will give you strength. You know, cast your cares upon Him, because He cares for you, the Peter told us. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you all. I've been rambling on already. God bless you all. You know that I love you all, and I appreciate you. I can't wait to see you guys in Nashville. I was supposed to go last year and didn't go. Sister Holly up there in West Virginia. Sister Paulette up in Ohio. That's a long way up there. I need to hear from people in Ohio and West Virginia. I mean, you know, I'm trying to be a good steward of my time, and, you know, it's expensive. And, you know, I don't even know if people will donate or not. I believe by faith. I'll just take that back. I know by faith God will make a way. But, you know, I'll go for one person if the Lord tells me to. But, I want to be a good steward. So I want to go to a place, and there's lots of people like Nashville or Dallas, Seattle, these kind of places, so I can get the most for the time, the effort, the finances it takes to go there. You know, so you guys, I know you understand that. Anyway, God bless you guys. Have a blessed day. May the Lord be with you always and keep you in all of your ways as he promised he would do. God bless you all in the name of Jesus.